truly, in Acts chapter 6, we're not going to really read that, but real quick, I'm just going to kind of look at the text, and I want to let you know a little bit about what's going on. So the church is being birthed, amen? You know, God's had a long history that he's been moving through the annals of human history. I've said that to you many times. I preach that way. I kind of try to always remind you that God's active and working in the midst of humanity. But at this point in time, Jesus has gone to the cross. I don't want to spend too much time here because I'm actually, this is part of my message. But Jesus has gone to the cross. The church has been birthed and the church is growing rapidly and disciples are being added to the church. And in this chapter 6, what's happening is that there's somewhat of a situation that has arisen. New converts are coming into the church. It's not just Jews. You see, the message of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was always previously centered upon the Jewish people because God had created for himself a people. Amen? How many times have I written that on the board and explained it? But for new people that haven't really heard it, God called that man named Abraham out. There was no nation called Israel before, but God called that man Abraham out. And in this message we're going to preach this morning, we're going to see that that is actually spoken in the midst of the message. That God called Abraham out, and through Abraham he created a nation. Amen. And so through that nation, he was dealing with the world on a grand scale. And through that nation, he gave us Jesus. And so now, though, Jesus has come and he's died on the cross and he's resurrected from the dead. Amen. And now the church has been birthed. The day of Pentecost has taken place and the Holy Spirit has filled the disciples. And they began to preach a message. Peter preached a message and 3,000 people were saved. And so now all of a sudden people are being added to the church. And the truth of the matter is that they were living in Jerusalem. And because of the fact that Jerusalem was the city that was built upon the nation of Israel, they were being persecuted for their faith. They were being lied about. I can tell you right now that there's some people in here that can tell you, Robert can tell you, there's some people that's lied about some of the ministry that we've done here. Anytime that you take a stand to preach the true gospel, a religious spirit will jump upon people and will begin to try to confront and confound and begin to say things. One time, somebody knows what I'm talking about. One time somebody said, man, you're in a cult. Hey, you got to be careful, dude. You're in a cult. Anytime that you're around somebody that thinks they got the only answer, you better be careful. You're in a cult. Well, no, not in a cult, trying to tell people that the only way to have access to the presence of God, the only way to have access to the Father of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is through faith in the sacrifice of the sinless Son that he sent, the incarnate one, the righteous one, who became flesh and offered his sinless life on the cross to pay the penalty of your sin. And when you place your faith in that, a declaration is spoken over your life. It's called justify. Hallelujah. You're no longer guilty. Now, if that sounds like heresy to you, if that sounds like cultic terminology, then the problem is that you hadn't been in the book because it's throughout the pages.
Amen.
I remember that person, and I'm not picking on them because you know what the sad thing is that they just didn't understand.
Amen.
They said it's not about the cross. It's about the Holy Spirit too. And whenever they told me that, man, I just felt like air left my lungs. As though I hadn't taken the time to read the Bible. As though I hadn't taken the time to understand that the Holy Spirit is active in the midst of the work of God. But the Holy Spirit works in your life and in my life based upon the finished work of Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Jesus dying and paying the penalty of your sin and my sin is what gives the Holy Spirit, when we put our faith in that, the liberty to be active and to move and to operate in the midst of our lives. And it's that, and it's only that.
That's right.
And so the Holy Spirit does want to move. He does want to operate, and he's doing it right here in the book of Acts. He's moving and he's operating, and people's lives are being changed, and disciples are being added to the midst of the church. And it's happening so rapidly, I'll be honest with you. At this point in time in the church, they don't even have, they're developing their doctrine, but they're still understanding Old Testament scriptures, and all this stuff about Jesus is happening in their heart is brand new revelation, and they're starting to make connections between the Old Testament and the New Testament, and they're seeing Jesus. All that time in the Old Testament where God was explaining through the tabernacle, through the sacrifices, and through all of these things, this is Jesus. It's like they're realizing the light's coming on. He was painting a picture for us all this time. For thousands of years, he was preparing us to be aware of when he was going to come. The disciples can see it. The religious people came. So Jerusalem is full of religious people. And they're persecuting the Christians. Won't give them jobs. You think the economy's bad now? Try to be a Christian in Jerusalem right now when the church is being birthed. That's why Paul had to go all over the place, not just to preach the gospel, to pick up an offering to bring it back to Jerusalem because they were starving over there. But nevertheless, they held on to Jesus in the midst of it all.
Amen.
And so in the midst of this, they're trying to distribute food also. And as they're distributing food, the disciples say, there becomes a murmuring amongst the people because Greek people are also becoming saved. Because see, the gospel is not just for Israel. The gospel is for the whole world. We're going to get into that in a second. The gospel is for the whole world. And now that these Grecian people are getting saved, some of the widows are being left out in the daily distribution of food. So the disciples said, you need to pick 7 men amongst yourselves who are full of who have an honest report, are full of the Holy Spirit, and have wisdom. You pick them from amongst yourselves. He's giving them the leeway. They're giving them the leeway. You got to determine what you think is a man of God, what you think is a woman of God. I wasn't planning on, but you can preach on that. You need to know enough about what the Word of God says about what a Christian's supposed to look like so that you can determine what a man of God looks like or what a woman of God looks like. I'm not talking about a perfect person. There was only one. His name was Jesus. I'm talking about somebody who walks and lives and breathes and desires to live for the things of God. Amen. Anyway, you need to pick 7 men like that. You need to have them to handle this food. You let them serve the tables. That's what it says in the text. That word serve is diakoneo, which actually is where we get our word deacon from. So these 7 men were the first deacons. That's kind of interesting. First time it hit me, I was like, wow, so a deacon is like a servant. It's a table waiter.
Yeah.
A deacon is a humble servant that's willing to wait on tables. He's not some dude that sits on a board in the midst of a church and tries to take over and tries to rule. Listen, I've been to some big churches, man. They got deacon boards and, oh, we're so high and mighty, you know, and we're going to control and we're going to manipulate. No, that's not what a deacon does. A deacon has a servant's heart. He wants to serve the Lord. He sees that something needs being done, and he's had a spirit of humility, and he desires to do the work of the Lord. See, that happens when you really get saved. Amen?
Amen.
When you really get saved, let me take a little step further. Not just when you really get saved, but when you surrender. When you surrender and bow your knee to Jesus, and you say, you know what, Lord? This ain't my show. I'm going to bow my knee to you. This isn't my show. This is your show. I want to bow my knee to you, and I want to live my life for you. Use me as a servant. Give me a spirit of humility so that I don't live my life just for myself. Amen.
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 And they found 7 men, and the Bible says that one of the men, he said, Stephen is the first one they listed. I want to talk to you about Stephen this morning. Stephen, a man full of the Holy Spirit. Oh, hallelujah. He started to talk in chapter 6. He was full of faith in the Holy Spirit. It also lists Philip after him. We're going to talk about him tonight. It says in verse 8, Stephen, full of faith, verse 8 of chapter 6, did great wonders and miracle among the people. Then there arose of the synagogue, which is called the synagogue of the Libertines and the Cyrenians and Alexandrians, and of them of Cilicia and of Asia, disputing with Stephen. And they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spoke. You know what? I think we changed our direction. We're not going to read the whole thing. We're going to preach it as we read. All right? Y'all cool with that?
Amen. Amen.
But you got your Bibles. Be ready. It says right here that he began to speak forth the things of God. He was full of faith. He was full of power. He did great wonders and miracles among the people. Then all of a sudden there arose from a certain synagogue, some people called the Libertines. When I studied into that, it means that they were Jews that had been given freedom from Rome. But not only that, there were Cyrenians. And basically the idea is that there's people from other locations, but they're all Jewish people. So they worship in the synagogue. So theoretically, they know the scriptures. You understand what I'm saying? Right now, do you understand that right now, at this point in the church, there's not a New Testament written? You may not have known that. So let me just tell you this. It's okay. We can do this because you know what? This is what we do. We're trying to make disciples. We're not trying to preach a groovy message and make everybody think the preacher's a good preacher. Okay. What we're trying to do is make sure that we understand some things. Mm-hmm. When you read the scriptures and you read the New Testament and it says that they committed themselves to the Word of God, there was no written New Testament during the time frame of the New Testament. But it's talking about the Old Testament. It's talking about they committed themselves to the Old Testament. They studied the scriptures and they were finding Jesus in the Old Testament. Does that make sense? I just want to make sure you understand that. All right, so they didn't have this body of knowledge that we talk about in the New Testament. That didn't come until on the heels of the book of Acts towards about AD 30. It started AD 50, AD 60, AD 90 is whenever the book of Revelation was written in the Gospel of John. So it was much later. All right. But so what's happening here is that Stephen is discussing the things of the Old Testament. And here we have some Jewish believers that begin to, the Word of God says that they begin to dispute with him. They were disputing with Stephen. In other words, dispute literally means to be in an argument with him. So what they're doing is, Stephen's breaking the rules. He's having a religious argument with people. I can't tell you how many times I've had people tell me that. Come on, man. You're not supposed to do that. You know better than that, Matt. You're not supposed to get into a religious discussion with people and cause a bunch of contention. Well, look, let's just follow Stephen's lead here. Let's see what Stephen did. Because, see, the truth of the matter is that there's right and there's wrong. And whenever people have wrong beliefs regarding their religion or regarding their faith, if somebody doesn't step up and let them know, now granted, there can be a right way to do it and a wrong way to do it. And we'll see when we're done if whether or not we think Stephen did it the right way or not, whether or not he got the results that he was really looking for. We'll figure that one out. But nevertheless, Stephen says, hold on a second. You need to understand God's doing something in the midst of this. He's doing something through this Jesus that we preach, and you need to be aware of what's taking place. God's on the move. Amen. And what ends up happening, though, is this, is that they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit, verse 10, by which he spoke. Hallelujah. Stephen was a man of God. He studied the scriptures to show himself approved, and he was full of the Holy Spirit of God, and he was confounding them with the wisdom of the scriptures. They could not call him to the carpet. They could not refute the things that he was saying. They were left in such a place that they were really dumbfounded and their mouth was shut. All right? And the Word of God goes on to say this. It goes on to say that they smuggled in the Greek is what it means. They smuggled in other men. Suborned them is what the old King James says. They smuggled in men to bring lies, to say that Stephen was blaspheming the nation of God, was blaspheming the temple of God, and were calling him to the carpet. And ultimately, what ended up happening was they brought him before the council to accuse him. And when they brought him before the council, it says in verse 15, and all that sat in the council, looking steadfastly on him, saw his face as it had been the face of an angel. Now, I wish that I could tell you. Now, what do you know what that means? It means that he was glowing. It means that the Holy Spirit was on Stephen. He was full of fire and the power of the Holy Spirit. And even his detractors and his enemies could see that the hand of God was on Stephen's life. I wish I could tell you that that changed the circumstance. I wish I could tell you that even though the enemies that looked at him and saw that the hand of God was upon his life made a decision to say, hey, maybe this guy has something that we should listen to. But the reality of it is that it's not the case. As we move through the story, we're going to see it just gets worse. Amen? Well, but what I wanted to tell you real quick was this. In Matthew chapter 21, there's a parable. And I wanted to try to make a little bit of a point to give you some background. In Matthew 21, there's a parable, and it's called the parable of the wicked husbandman. And in this parable, it starts in Matthew 21, verse 33. It says that there was a certain householder. That means he owned the property. And he had a vineyard. And he hedged it round about, and he digged a wine press in it, and he built a tower, and he let it out to husbandmen, and he went into a far country. Now, if you don't understand what a husbandman is, because it's kind of an outdated word, the science of husbandry has to do with crops and agriculture and taking care of vineyards, okay? And also to take care of other people's affairs. So in a certain sense, these husbandmen were people that were hired by the household, the owner, the landowner, to take care of his property and to tend the vineyard. The parable is speaking of the kingdom of God, amen? And it's speaking of the fact that God is a householder. and he owns some things. And that he entrusted this property to be taken care of by the nation of Israel that he had created. Amen. He had created Israel with his own word, with his own hands, and he entrusted them to take care of this property that he left them with. Well, this is what happens. He did all of this work. He went into a far country. And when the time of the fruit drew near, so it's time now for the harvest to begin to at least get ready. Because this is the time frame when Jesus is about to show up right here. See, to you, that's been 2,000 years. That seems like a long time. To God, it just seems like yesterday. The truth of the matter is, when Jesus showed up, everything was starting to change. We were already getting closer to the harvest. We're so much closer to it today than we were back then. Amen?
Amen.
It goes on to say that, and when the time of the fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the husbandmen that they might receive the fruits of it. And the husbandmen took his servants and beat one and killed another and stoned another. See, Israel did that to the prophets. As God sent the prophets to speak to them and to warn them about their disobedience and the things that they were doing that were contrary to God, instead of listening and giving their ear to the word, instead they beat them up and they killed them. And it goes on to say that he sent other servants and they did the same thing to them in verse 37. But last of all, he sent unto them his son, saying, they will reverence my son. But when the husbandmen saw the son, they said among themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him and let us seize his inheritance. And they caught him and cast him out of the vineyard and slew him. When the Lord, therefore, of the vineyard comes, what will he do unto those husbandmen? So Jesus is asking these Pharisees who he's telling this parable to. You know what's interesting to me is that Stephen's telling these religious leaders in Acts chapter 7 that we're about to get into, and Jesus is telling the Pharisees right here, he's saying, what you think God's going to do to those husbandmen, those wicked men that didn't do what they were supposed to do? He's talking to them. Can you see the picture? He's talking to them. He has a little bit of veiled language, but they're not dumb. They know who he's talking to, and they know what he's saying. You haven't been faithful with the things that God entrusted to you. What do you think he's going to do? He's going to turn around and he's going to give it to somebody else, they said. He goes on to say, they say unto him, he will miserably destroy those wicked men and will let out his vineyard unto other husbandmen, which shall render him the fruits in their season. Jesus saith unto them, Did you never read in the scriptures, the stone which the builders rejected, the same has become the head of the corner? What does that mean? That, you know what a cornerstone is? Back in those days, they didn't pour a slab for a foundation. They had a cornerstone, and it was the first piece that they did in order to produce the foundation. So the Word of God, and I didn't plan this, but almost in about three or four different scriptures, I believe, that I put in here, it keeps talking about this stone that the builders rejected. Who's the builders? Israel. Israel were the people that God entrusted to build upon the kingdom of God, but they rejected the very cornerstone, which was ultimately Jesus that was manifest. And he goes on to say that they stumbled over it. That the reality of it is that he was the plan all along. God had prepared them to understand that. He had painted it through the scriptures, but that they missed it. It goes on to say, therefore, verse 43, I say unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you, and this is where I wanted to go, and given to a nation, bringing forth the fruits thereof. And whosoever shall fall on this stone shall be broken, but on whomsoever it shall fall, it will grind him to powder. See, it's okay if you trip over the cornerstone. Yeah, you might haphazardly be walking blindly and not even know it. Somebody told you about Jesus and you tripped over it, amen? And you might have fallen down. You might have fallen down a few times since you met the cornerstone. It's one thing to fall over it. It's a whole other thing to reject it and to allow it to be placed upon you and to crush you.
Amen.
It goes on to say, and when the chief priests and Pharisees heard these parables, they perceived that he spoke of them. But when they sought to lay hands on him, they feared the multitude because they took him for a prophet. You see, Jesus is telling them the truth. Mm-hmm. And the response to this, because they don't like it, because it's contrary to what they understand, is that they desire to kill him. They desire to take him by force. It's a spirit of religion.
Right.
You understand that a spirit of religion has an unteachable spirit behind it. If you ever try to talk to anybody that has a spirit of religion, they have an unteachable spirit. When you try to share something with them, then you can't get through to them. It's as though it doesn't matter how much you've tried to study. It doesn't matter how calm you try to stay. Sometimes, you know what? They're looking for the first thing that they can talk to you about or look upon you with to say, you know what? You're invalidated in my eyes. And that's what's going on here. It's a spirit of religion, man. Don't be bound by a spirit of religion. Don't have an unteachable spirit. I'm talking to the preacher. Sometimes I just need to shut my mouth and listen. Amen? Sometimes I just need to shut up and listen to what other people are saying. Now, I got to tell you, it's going to sound arrogant, but it's not. I've listened to so many people and had so many conversations about false religion. It only takes about 3 minutes now. It only takes about 3 minutes to figure out where your doctrine is. I know that sounds bad, right? But I don't mean it the wrong way. And it's within 3 minutes that I can figure it out. And it's like, that's why I can't keep my mouth shut. Because I want to go ahead and interject. And I want to say, hold on, man. Stop. Let's slow down. Let's discuss this. Let's reason together. Let's try to get this thing right. Amen. And if you got something to refute, then tell me about it. Amen. Amen? But anyway, sometimes I just need to learn to shut up. I need to just learn to shut up and listen. All right, I'm using myself as an example. Amen? Because I know that there's some other people in here that need to do that too. Amen? That's just the truth, right? It's okay to tell the truth, right? Amen? Y'all, that's why y'all love me, right? Thank you, Jesus. All right, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 4. So we were talking about a nation. Jesus said, therefore I say unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you, and it'll be given to a nation that is going to bring forth the fruits thereof. So real quick, I want to talk about that nation. And then this is part of my introduction, all right, to Stephen. It says in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 through 10, to whom coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious. Well, here we are again about a stone, a living stone. It's talking about Jesus right here. He's the living stone. And he was disallowed indeed by men. In other words, Israel rejected him, but chosen of God and precious. Ye also as lively stones are built up a spiritual house. So Jesus is the cornerstone. A foundation has been laid off of his work. And now you get life from Jesus when you put your faith in him. You become a lively stone. And as new lively stones are placed upon the foundation, it's as though a habitation or a building or a house is being built called the church, the body of Christ, a place for the presence of God, the Spirit of God to dwell, amen, so that God can reveal himself to a darkened world, so the light of God can shine to a darkened world out there. But whenever the stone doesn't want to become lively, it doesn't want to get set in its proper position so that the house of God can be built up. And I'm not talking about this building. I'm talking about the body of Christ. But you know what? We have to worry ourselves about the people that sit in this building. Yeah. Let God make you a lively stone. Amen? Yeah. Let God make you a lively stone. Let him breathe some life on the inside of you. And the hunger of God and the hunger for his word, amen, to come alive on the inside of you. Amen. So that his presence can dwell in you. Amen. And so that the work of God can come through you, yes, and touch other people's lives. Amen. Amen. He goes on to say, he wants to make you a spiritual house. Verse 5, a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Yes. Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, behold, here we go, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. If you'll put your faith in Jesus, you're not going to be confused. If you don't keep your faith in Jesus, you're going to wander around in a wilderness. Yeah. You're going to wander around in a wilderness and you're going to find yourself in a confused state. Yes. Not knowing which direction that you're going. Amen. Stay focused on Jesus. Yes. Unto you therefore which believe he is precious, but unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner. And a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but now are the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. What I was trying to get across to you with that is this, is that the time frame of Israel has now at least taken a break. We've been studying the book of Daniel on Thursday nights, and we got to a spot in Daniel where there's a prophecy that takes place, and in Daniel's prophecy, it doesn't mention the church age. It doesn't mention the church age because the Jewish people were blinded to the church age. Because Jesus said whenever he came, if you would have recognized the day of your visitation, then you would have received your Redeemer. Because you rejected him, now you've been blinded and it's been hidden from you. And so for this period of time that we've been going through the church age, Israel has been blinded to the moving and operation of God, but it doesn't mean that God's done with them. Amen? What I'm trying to tell you is this, is that there was a nation that God had created, but they weren't faithful with what God entrusted to them. And when that time frame came to an end and Jesus came, he did that, he spoke that parable after the triumph and entry and before the cross about the wicked husbandman. And he told those Pharisees that, and he said the kingdom of God is going to be taken away from you, and it's going to be given to a nation that will bear fruit unto God. And the nation that he was speaking of was the fact that he was going to create the church, a nation of people that are all across the globe. Amen? There's people that work at the machine shop. There's people that work at the doctor's office, the dentist's office, the diamond tank place. And that's just Morgan City, Patterson area. There's people all over the globe. In China, in underground churches. They're all over the place. And they're a holy nation. They're lively stones that are being built up and the Holy Spirit's living in them. And they're supposed to show forth the praises of him that called us out of darkness and into his marvelous light. And so that's what happened. Jesus showed up. He goes to the cross on the Passover. Amen. He resurrects on the Feast of First Fruits. 50 days later, the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit falls. And the disciples are filled up with the Holy Spirit. Peter preaches the first Holy Spirit message. Amen. He says, he basically said, death couldn't hold him down. He said, King David, don't you remember King David told us that his body would not decay in the ground? He wasn't talking about himself. King David was in the tomb. He was prophetically uttering the fact that the seed of David, the righteous king, the eternal king, would come and that death wouldn't hold him down. And 1,000 years later, as it came to pass, Jesus resurrected from the dead. And on that morning, hallelujah. On that morning, the next thing you know, it says they were pricked in their heart. It means to agitate, to irritate. Have you ever had somebody tell you something that's true and it irritates you? Come on. They were pricked in their heart. They were irritated. They were agitated. This is what they told Peter. What must we do to be saved? You got to repent.
Amen.
You got to repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Put your faith in him. And when you put your faith in him, in the mind of God, the old man born of Adam dies and is baptized into his death, his burial, and baptized into the resurrection. Amen. And then when you go in the water, hallelujah, it physically represents what's already taking place spiritually.
Yes.
New creation in Christ.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Peter preached it. 3,000 souls were added to the church that day. Next message, 5,000 souls added to the church. And then all of a sudden they're distributing food. And they don't have enough, and the Grecian widows are murmuring. And now we need deacons, we need servants. And here's this humble servant named Stephen, full of the power of God, full of the Holy Spirit, full of the Word of God. And he says, you know what? If God has used me to serve at a table, he'll use me to speak forth the Word of God to some people that need to hear it. And as God begins to use him, he begins to confound even those that have studied the Scriptures. And now he stands in front of a council with his face glowing like that of an angel, the power of God emanating off of him. And here he goes. He's going to start talking. This is what he says in Acts chapter 7. He says, then the high priest said, are these things so? All these accusations that they speak against you, is it true, Stephen? And he said, men, brethren, fathers, hearken. The God of glory appeared unto our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia before he dwelt in Haran. It's got a C right there, but it's pronounced Haran. Listen, we're not going to read all this verse by verse. We're just going to go through and use the Bible as our text to keep us straight, okay? Mesopotamia. What is that? This right here, this is the Sea of Galilee. This is the Dead Sea. This area, this is the Jordan River. This area right here between these two spots is known as Palestine now. It's known as, well, it's known as Israel now. During the British Empire, it was known as Palestine. During the time frame that he's talking about, when Abraham was called, it was known as the land of Canaan. Also known as the Promised Land, this strip of land right here. This place right here, this is the Tigris and the Euphrates River. This is modern day Iraq. This place right here was called Mesopotamia. What does Mesopotamia mean? It means the land between the rivers. Abraham lived somewhere over here. Stephen starts his message off by saying, hey, do you remember Father Abraham? Do you remember Father Abraham and the fact that he was in Mesopotamia and that God called him out? God called him out and he promised him something. And what he promised him property and he promised him a people. He said that through you there's going to be a seed. And you know what got me so excited? When I just all of a sudden the Lord dropped Stephen in my spirit. And I started reading his message and I said, I became a preacher like Stephen. This is maybe where I got it from and didn't even realize. Stephen preaching the salvation history of God. And he starts off with this counsel as he speaks to them anointed by the power of the Holy Spirit. And he said, don't you remember our father Abraham? You think that God's only wanting to move in Jerusalem. You think God's only wanting to move in Israel. You think that God's only wanting to move in this building that you have right here. But I'm here to tell you, God called Abraham out when there was no Israel. God called Abraham out from a foreign land. And the Bible goes on to say that in Stephen's message, he said, and Abraham had Isaac, and Isaac had Jacob, and Jacob had the 12 tribes. And he said this, he said, and then those 12 men moved with envy, sold their brother Joseph into slavery. I'm just thinking right now that while Stephen's preaching this message and these religious leaders are full of envy, they're full of envy because Christianity's taken over. They're full of envy because Stephen is full of the power of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God, and they can't contend with the Spirit that's living on the inside of, him. And they're so full of envy that they're becoming more and more angry as every word comes out of his mouth. And let me tell you something, he can tell when he's looking in their eyes how they're feeling towards the message that he's preaching, and he won't stop because they need to hear the truth today.
Amen.
He goes on to tell him, don't you remember our father Abraham? But what happens is that his own brothers, listen, this is Israel before there was an Israel. You hear me? The 12 tribes, before they ever even made it all the way over here, they moved with envy and they sold their brother into slavery. But I got good news for you. See, they didn't want to listen to Joseph the first time he talked. When he told him about that dream, they didn't want to listen to him the first time, but they sure listened to him the second time. Mm-hmm. See, God had preordained something. He had set it up. Now, I want you to know that God moves and operates even in the midst of our failures.
Amen.
He does. I'm not sitting here telling you let's go out and fail and see what God's going to do. That's not what I'm saying. But what I am going to tell you is this, because I don't normally say this kind of thing, but I'm going to say it. Listen to me. If you failed, don't let the devil beat you up.
Amen.
If you messed up, don't let the devil beat you up. Get up, man. The Word of God says a righteous man gets up seven times. Put your faith in Jesus. Say, Lord, work in me and do something in me. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God works in the midst of his people's failure.
Yeah.
Those boys were moved with envy and they sent Joseph as a slave, but God had a plan. God was going to use Joseph, amen, to the famine was coming. And God used Joseph to prepare ahead of time. And when the famine came, God drove Jacob and his boys to Egypt, where there was plenty of food so that they could be taken care of. As I was reading there, I felt like the Lord wanted me to tell somebody this morning, God knows how to move his people.
Amen.
He knows how to move his people to the place where he desires to get them.
Yeah.
Sometimes he has to let a famine strike.
That's right.
Sometimes he has to allow some untoward circumstances to take place.
Yes.
Now, come on.
That's right.
See, this won't go. This won't fly in the modern day prosperity message. Oh, no, preacher, I'm the righteousness of God. Oh, no, preacher, I just got to confess the right thing and all the blessings of God are going to go. Oh, come on, somebody. They're saying one thing out of their mouth and their life's in shambles on the backside that you can't see.
Amen.
The reality of it is this. God uses trial and tribulation in the life of his people to show them some things about themselves, and also at the same time, he's still sovereign and he's getting stuff done. Amen?
Amen.
And so there it was in the time frame of Joseph that God prepared it to preserve a seed. And I preached that not that long ago. Then if you think about it, what happened was is that in the middle of that Joseph story in the Old Testament, all of a sudden there pops in something about the seed of Judah. That whole purpose of Joseph was to preserve the seed of Israel, specifically the seed of Judah, so that we could ultimately have Jesus. God is in advance, knowing what he's doing. You and I need to be aware of that. You and I need to get on board with what he's doing, amen, and to trust him in the midst of this thing. This thing is real, folks. Jesus is real. The plan of God is real. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. He goes on to say that he was moved upon, he talks about Joseph, and he talks about Egypt, and he says that Abraham was given the promise of a seed. And ultimately, what he's also trying to tell these people is that God has a plan, and ultimately the seed was Jesus. And he goes on to say in verse, so the first time, whenever Joseph spoke, they wouldn't listen to him. But like I told you, the second time they did, that's what it says in verse 13. Verse 13 of Acts chapter 7. And at the second time, Joseph was made known to his brethren, and Joseph's kindred was made known unto Pharaoh. Second time when they went over there and they saw that God had been in the midst of this. And you remember what Joseph said? What you meant for evil, God has turned around for good.
Amen.
You know, it's easy when you find yourself in the midst of untoward circumstances to get bitter. I didn't plan this. I didn't write this in my notes. But I think about Joseph's life. I think about what he went through. I think about how people lied about him. I think about how he tried his best to live for God. Amen. He tried to make the right decisions. And he found himself in the midst of a bad circumstances. And all that time, he never knew exactly what God's plan was. God gave him revelation. God gave him revelation about other people's lives. He gave him revelation about the baker's life. I don't think the baker liked that story of what his dream was, that he was going to die the next day. He gave him revelation about the cupbearer's dream.
Yeah.
He gave him revelation about a lot of things, but he didn't really tell Joseph, I don't believe right there. It doesn't say that he did. It wasn't until the very end that Joseph realized what God had planned the whole time. And that God was up to something.
Yes.
And sometimes we just don't know what God's up to.
Right.
But we got to trust Him.
Amen.
We got to trust
Amen.
Him in the midst of it all and believe that He's up to something. Amen. And that He's moving and He's operating in the midst of our circumstances. I just want to encourage you. And that's from the Holy Spirit. That wasn't written in the notes. Somebody needed to hear that. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know your story.
Amen.
But I will tell you this. If you'll trust Him, amen, God's going to get you through. Don't let the root of bitterness sink into your heart.
Amen.
Don't become so angry at someone because they did you wrong that you let bitterness overwhelm you. Bitterness will destroy your walk with God.
Amen?
Amen. It'll happen. Don't let it in. And how I stop it, preacher? Why don't you give me a little wisdom on that? I'll just tell you the same way I do it. When I realize somebody's coming against me, I kind of try to do what Stephen did, and we'll get to it at the end. But this is what I do, is I cry out to the Lord, Lord, please give me your love for that person because it's not in me. If you leave me to myself and you do me wrong, the lust of the flesh wants Matt to become angry, wants Matt to retaliate against you. But I know my Jesus well enough to know this. I'm not saying I always act like him, but I know my Jesus well enough to know this. He loves people even when they do it wrong. Come on.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. And so it goes on to say that Joseph was in this time frame. And then the next thing you know, it says that, and it says it in the scripture, moving closer down to verse 17 or 16 and 17, that the idea has to do with the fact that there was a new Pharaoh that showed up one day. And he didn't know Joseph, because by this time Joseph was dead. And the new Pharaoh showed up and he began to enslave the children of Israel. But even in that, God had a plan. Because see, in their slavery, they swelled into a great nation. God was preparing them. He had a place for them. Amen. And ultimately, one day, Moses was born. Verse 19. Verse 20. Moses was born and was exceedingly fair and nourished up in his father's house for 3 months. And when he was cast out, Pharaoh's daughter took him up and nourished him for her own son. I preached that multiple times. I love that little story. I'm going to tell it to you again. They put Moses, you know what they did? I'm going to keep reminding you of this, okay, so that it's real thick, real concrete in your mind. I missed the spot. Verse 8, it said right here, he gave them the covenant of circumcision. God gave Abraham the covenant of circumcision, the cutting away of the foreskin, for a purpose, because he was looking for a separated people.
Yeah.
It was the sign of their covenant. It's kind of weird to us today to talk about that, but it just is what it is. Not weird for me because I'm a nurse practitioner and I deal with it all day long. But nevertheless, some people get the heebie-jeebies about it. This is the thing. It was a covenant. It showed them that they were a separated people. They looked different.
Amen.
They looked different than everybody else. And Moses was born in his own house, and on the eighth day, according to the law, he was circumcised. Moses is about 400 years after Abraham, but they're still doing it. Because they're at least being faithful to this part of the Word of God. 400 years later, they're still cutting off the foreskin, circumcising their young boys on the eighth day because they were supposed to be a separated people unto God. And there was Moses in that little basket They put some tar underneath it, and they floated him down the Nile River, and he got caught in the bulrushes, and there's Pharaoh's daughter. I love this story. Y'all getting tired of it yet? I've told it a million times. Pharaoh's daughter reaches over. I just love whenever I saw it for the first time, because it doesn't say it in the text, but I know it's true, that she lifted up that little blanket, and she saw it. She said, oh, it's a Hebrew boy. There's only one way she knew it was a Hebrew boy. It's because he was circumcised. He was in covenant with God. He was different than her little brother. He was different than if she ended up having any offspring, because they didn't do that. And she ended up taking that boy and raising him. She raised him in Pharaoh's house, and he went to the best schools. And he learned all the newest innovations of the day. And then that's how he grew up. And then one day, the word of God says that he went out to look upon the plight of his own people. And Stephen's preaching this right now. It's not me preaching. Stephen's preaching it. He's preaching it to the council. I need to remind you about some things about your nation. I need to remind you about some things about your God. I need to remind you that God's been moving throughout human history. Do you remember Abraham? Do you remember the story of Joseph? Do you remember the story of Moses and how he was found? And then one day he went out to look upon the plight of his people. And he saw that there were two Hebrew men that were at contention, and an Egyptian was in the midst of it. And Moses tried to stop the situation. He wanted to deliver them even from the Egyptian person. Also, Moses killed that Egyptian, buried him in the sand. The Bible says, oh, this gives me hope. Because the Bible says Moses looked to the left, and then he looked to the right, and then he killed that Egyptian and he buried him in the sand. Why does that give you hope, preacher? Because I realize God uses imperfect people.
Amen.
And listen to me, he buried that Egyptian in the sand. And the next day, Moses, that's what Stephen's talking about, went back out there and he found that Hebrew again. And he tried to talk to him. And you know what that Hebrew person said? Who called you? I'm putting words in the mouth, but this is the idea. Who called you to be our deliverer? Well, God did. And God called me to be the deliverer. But this is the point. The first time Moses showed up, they didn't receive him. The first time Joseph talked to his brothers, they didn't receive him, but they heard him the second time. The first time Moses showed up, they didn't receive him, but they listened to him the second time. And the first time Jesus showed up, because Moses also said, and Stephen tells them this in his message. He tells these religious leaders, this Moses is the same one that told you that another prophet would arise. Moses prophesied it out of his own mouth, Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 15, that another prophet would arise from amongst your people, and him you will listen to. Moses was prophesying about Jesus, but they didn't listen to him. Not the first time. They're going to listen to him the second time. When he comes back as a conquering king, Zechariah chapter 12, they're going to realize that they had signed a covenant with the Antichrist. They're going to realize that they were deceived, and Jesus is coming back, and they're going to realize that they pierced him, that they crucified him, and that they're going to put their faith in him, and they're going to accept him as Messiah and ask forgiveness of their sins as a nation, and God is going to use them in the last days in the millennial reign of Christ.
Amen.
He says that about Moses. They didn't receive him at first, but then he heard the burning bush. He heard the voice from the burning bush. He said, I am. Tell my people that I'm going to deliver them. And you know what? It also said that they had, Stephen let them know, he reminded them this, you're so worried about your temple, but do you remember that? They had the tabernacle of witness in the wilderness. The tabernacle of witness, that tent where the presence of God lived, where the law of God, the word of God lived inside that box called the Ark of the Covenant, where the blood was placed every once a year on the Day of Atonement, and the presence of God dwelled with them. It was a witness that God dwelled with his people. The word witness right there in the Greek is martyrion. It's where we get our word martyr. It was interesting to me to see that because Stephen, we hadn't got there yet, was the first martyr of the New Testament.
Praise God.
Oh, thank you, Jesus. There's a witness in the land. A tent was wandering around in the wilderness with Israel. The witness, the tabernacle of witness. God's presence was with them, and now God's presence is in the midst of Stephen's life. His face is shining and glowing like an angel. He's anointed by the power of the Holy Spirit, and he's speaking forth the truth of God's word to a dying religious society.
Amen.
If that don't sound like where we live right now, I don't know what is. We need to get full of the Holy Spirit, and we need to quit thinking everybody's saved that doesn't know the real Jesus. Mm-hmm. And we need to start telling the truth.
Yeah.
So that people might be saved from their condition.
Amen.
He goes on to say in this passage, that from the tabernacle, he starts talking about the house of God. He says that in verse 46, that God moved the people of Canaan out, and that David, look right here, it says right here in verse 45, which also our fathers that came after brought in with Jesus. That was a bad translation. That should have said Joshua right there. All right. Joshua brought the children of Israel into the promised land. Jesus is the Greek version of the name Joshua. All right. Into possession of the Gentiles whom God drove out before the face of our fathers unto the days of David. So not only did God move the enemy out of the land, but they brought the witness or the tabernacle with them into the new land. Then it says, it talks about David, and then it says, who found favor before God? Who did? David found favor before God, and he desired to find a tabernacle for the God of Jacob. So David comes into the house of God. David becomes the king of Israel, and he desires to build a house for the presence of God. But the word of the Lord says in the book of Chronicles that David wasn't allowed to build that house because he was a man of war. And then I'm closing. I'm getting close. Hang with me. Okay. And then the Bible says this. It says that that house was built by Solomon. But then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, Stephen shifts gears. I mean, I'm telling you, everything is bad enough. He's basically talking to him like, don't you know this? Don't you remember this? And then all of a sudden, he shifts gears. And this is what he says. He says, but Solomon built him a house, verse 48, howbeit the Most High dwells not in temples made with hands, as says the prophet. I want you to remember that right there. Because Paul preached that about 15 years later. Paul preached that same line 15 years later to the Grecians over there on Mars Hill. I want you to know Stephen had an impact on Paul's life. And you never know who you're living your life in front of. You never know when you're speaking the word of God, who's listening. I'm telling you, God will use you if you have a humble heart. Amen. And you'll be a servant of God. He goes on to say that. He said, God's presence doesn't dwell in temples that are made with man's hands. Man, that's the gospel. Ezekiel 36, God promised that he was going to place his spirit in the new covenant on the inside of you. Amen. When you put your faith in Jesus, the Holy Spirit came to live on the inside of you. You became the tabernacle of the living God. I'm talking about when you got saved. The first day you got saved, when it really happened, the Holy Spirit came to live in you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. He lives in you. Amen. He dwells in you.
Amen.
He wants to use you. He goes on to say, heaven is my throne. I know I'm wearing yellow, buddy. Just hang in there. Heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool. And what house will you build me, says the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? That comes out of Isaiah 66. That's what the Lord, that's what the prophet said. They were over there worried about building all of these temples. And the prophet spoke for God and says, what are you going to build for me? Heaven is where I live. Earth is my footstool. What are you going to build for me? No, this is who my heart looks towards. He who is humble of a contrite spirit and trembles at my word. That's who God's looking for even today. God has a plan. And he's wanting and desires for his presence to be able to dwell with his people. Heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool. What house will you build me, says the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? Verse 50. Has not my hand made all these things? And then look at this. This is where he really shifts gears right here. I want you to see this. Look what he does. Man, was he right? Was he wrong? Was he supposed to talk to people this way? I don't know. You be the judge. You stiff-necked and uncircumcised and hardened ears. He said, your neck is stiff. You've been asleep so long in the wrong position that when somebody tries to tell you something, you can't even move your head the right way. You got a stiff neck and you got an uncircumcised heart. You want to talk about circumcision in the Old Testament? God's plan was always to get on the inside and to be able to perform a surgery on the inside of the heart where man will start to listen, and you're missing the whole thing. You do always resist the Holy Ghost as your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? Which is going to read now and let Stephen preach. And they have slain them which showed before of the coming of the just one. Talking about Jesus. Of whom you have been now the betrayers and the murderers. That's what you did. You murdered Jesus. You betrayed him. And you killed him and you hung him on a cross. who have received the law by disposition of angels and have not kept it. You, Israel, who had been given the law, the very word of God, and it was in your heart, whenever the Messiah came and he came for you, you instead hung him on a tree, even though God prepared you in advance. It says right here, verse 54, when they heard these things, they were cut to the heart. They weren't just pricked, they were cut to the heart. And they gnashed on him with their teeth. You know, the word of God says that in hell there's going to be weeping and gnashing of teeth.
Yeah.
These guys were so angry. Did you see Mike Tyson when he fought Evander Holyfield? Y'all are young, huh? I'm old. He gnashed on Tyson. Tyson gnashed on that boy's ear. Y'all remember that face he had when he reached around and he bit the tip of his ear off? That's not what happened to me. I got hit with a baseball bat. But listen, he bit the guy's ear off. Yeah. He was under a demonic influence. You could see it in his eyes. Y'all saw that fight. Y'all know what I'm talking about. That was a demon in him. He was serving Allah. And Evander Holyfield came out there with a scripture, Philippians 4:13, on his collar. And that demon reached over there and bit that man's ear off. They were gnashing on him with their teeth. They were being led demonically to chew on flesh. Come on, don't be a flesh eater. Don't go after flesh. Come on, somebody. But see, they were going after flesh, but look at what it says about Stephen in verse 55. But he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God.
Hallelujah.
See, I don't know what you're going through today, and I don't know who's doing you dirty. Come on, somebody. You don't have to raise your hand, but you know good and well somebody did you dirty recently. And you got to question yourself how you're going to handle this thing. Stephen chose to look steadfastly towards heaven and to put his gaze upon the Lord. While all this is going on, Stephen chooses to look to Jesus. And listen, this was going to be the title of my message. I forgot to tell you. Jesus stood up. Jesus stood up. The word of God says that he looked up to heaven and he saw Jesus standing up. That got my attention. Because see, it says in the book of the Hebrews that this man sat down. Jesus sat down because his work was finished. The word of God says that the Old Testament priests never sat down. They constantly stood because they had to minister every day, because they had an unceasing supply of sacrifices that had to be offered. But Jesus, after he offered himself one time for the sins of man, sat down at the right hand of God until his enemies be made his footstool. But when Stephen showed up and preached the gospel and told religion that they were living a lie, and all of a sudden they gnashed on him with their teeth and he put his eyes towards heaven, Jesus stood up. I don't know that he's ever going to stand up for me or that he's ever going to stand up for you, but I sure hope that I at least get his attention. Amen. Lord, fill my mouth with your words and fill my lungs with your breath and help us, Lord, to do the work of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
He looked at Jesus. Jesus is standing up. It says right here, verse 56. And said, behold, I see the heavens opened, the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. Verse 57. Then they cried with a loud voice and they stopped up their ears and they ran upon him with one accord. Can you imagine this? Grown men. Ah! I don't want to hear what you're saying anymore. Ah! Full of anger. Being driven by demon spirits. Full of the wrath of God. Stopping up their ears and screaming and running upon him. And they overtook him by force. You know, somebody like me, man, I like to think I'm tough, but I'm going to be honest with you. I don't know if I would have been able to withstand. This is the Holy Spirit right here.
Yeah, right.
This is the Holy Spirit giving this man a backbone.
Amen.
I don't care how tough you think you are. You stand in front of a council, and you start seeing their face change towards you,
yeah.
And they're licking their chops because they want to eat your flesh.
Right. Amen.
You need a backbone from the Holy Ghost.
That's right.
Amen. It goes on to say right here, verse 58, and cast him out of the city. Now the idea here is, y'all just bear with me, this is a good story. Cast him out of the city. Now whenever they go to stone somebody, they find a little hill and they throw him down off of it to talk his breath out. Then they get some big old stones and they start chunking it down on him, trying to hit him in the mediastinum or the chest area, try to mess up those great vessels, maybe tear your bronchial tubes, you can't breathe. While all this is going on, they threw him down, they start to stone him. And the witnesses laid their clothes at a young man's feet whose name was Saul. Now you got to just stop right there for a second. This is the pre-converted Saul, Paul. The mighty apostle Paul. Wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. Went on 3 to 4 missionary trips. died in Rome while he was in the Mamertine prison. Wrote to 2 Timothy, don't forget the scrolls, don't forget my little cloak, bring them to me when you come. Everybody's forsaken me. Everybody's forsaken me as I preach the gospel and I sit here in this wet, damp prison. Won't you come and visit me before, because the time is almost over. I fought a good fight. I've kept the faith. I've kept the faith, and now I'm going home. They're about to put my head on the chopping block. They're about to take it away from my body. But don't forget the scrolls. I need to read the word. I need to get into the word because I love God's word. And you know, all I can say is that I'm just blown away. I'm blown away by the fact that right here, the unconverted Saul is standing here, and it means that he's giving consent to them. They take their clothes off and they lay it at his feet and they're asking permission. Is it okay if we go forward with the stoning? And Paul's part of it. And he's listening to all this and he's watching all this. And right now he's full of anger and he's got the same demonic oppression on him because he's like, yeah, kill him. Stone him. And he's watching Stephen. And he watches. He looks up and he says, I see the Son of God. And he's standing at the right hand of God. And they're over there blocking up their ears and screaming. And Paul's watching the whole thing. And then he goes on to say this. And he kneeled down. So he's already on the ground. They've hit him with a couple of rocks. But he finds the power to get on his knee. And he kneels down on his knees. And this is what he says. He cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Same heart of Jesus. Same heart of Jesus as he hangs on the cross. And people have ripped his beard out. And they've blindfolded him. And they slapped him. They put the crown of thorns on his head and they slapped him. Took a rod and started hitting him on the crown of thorns. Put a little, lashed him with the whip. Put a purple robe on his back. Hey, Son of God, Son of Man, prophesy. Prophesy who it is that striketh thee. Go on and tell us, since you are who you say you are. And then as he hangs there naked on the cross, the world passes by and they shake their head and they say, look at him. He said he was going to be able to do this and that, man. He can't even save himself. And then religion walks by and says, why don't you go ahead and take yourself down off the cross, then maybe we'll believe you. And all this time, Jesus is just taking it all. And one of his last words that he says is, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's not the words of just a man.
Amen.
That's the words of God flowing through a man. And it's the same heart that flowed through Stephen's heart. And he said, Father, lay not this charge against them. They know not what they're doing. And he fell asleep. Chapter 8, verse 1 says, and Saul was consenting unto his death. And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea, Samaria, except the apostles. Stephen's death fueled a fire. You can try to stop the move of God on the earth. The spirit of Antichrist is trying to stop it. You got all kind of little people that are jumping on board with him. The music industry, Hollywood, everybody, you don't have to believe it. It doesn't matter to me whether you believe it or not. I'm here to tell you that there is a force on this earth that is trying to drive people away from the real Jesus.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And we got to determine in our hearts whose team we're going to be on.
Amen.
And I'm telling you, one day you're going to breathe your last breath here and you're going to breathe your first breath
That's
there.
Right.
And you're going to wish and hope that you had chosen the right Jesus and that
Amen.
You fell asleep
Amen.
With the same spirit in you that was in Stephen. Listen to me. Tonight I want to talk about two men. I want to talk about Saul, who watched all this happen. And I want to talk about Philip, who was the second deacon that was mentioned whenever they picked seven. And I want to show you the impact I believe that Stephen had in their life, at least that they loved the Lord and they became preachers of the gospel. And I want you to know that you never know who's watching you. Three things I wanted to leave you with, points to remember. All right, you ready? Then we close. Stephen was a humble servant and God used him so big that Jesus stood up. When we decide to allow ourselves to be used by God, we should be reminded to rethink our motives and make sure that it's for His exaltation and not our own.
Amen.
Do you hear that?
Amen.
When you decide to be used by God, wherever it is that you're working, whether you're playing the drums, whether you're playing the guitar, whether you're singing on the stage, whether you're the preacher behind the pulpit, whether you're helping the children, or whether you're cleaning the toilets.
Amen.
You know the person that's cleaning the toilets is doing it for the Lord, because nobody even knows who they are except for me and maybe Robert. My point is that that, are you trying to be exalted and to be seen? Or are you trying to exalt Jesus?
Amen.
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 I'm not scared to clean the toilet, by the way, so if anybody wants to quit, it's still going to get done. No, that's not true. I need to be nice. Thank y'all for cleaning the toilet. Y'all know me. When people are, this is point number two. When people are trying to destroy you, retaliation won't work. You can't try to respond by gnashing on somebody's flesh. It's not going to work. You can't gnash back with your teeth, put your eyes on Jesus, and pray that he won't hold their sin against them. Yeah. That's a hard thing to do, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because in your own flesh, you want vengeance. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Some of you know what I'm talking about because we've talked about it before.
Mm-hmm.
In your own flesh, you want vengeance.
Amen.
But that's not how God works.
That's right.
As a matter of fact, he will hold back from you
what
you desire to receive from God, because you're harboring bitterness.
Amen.
And a desire for your own vengeance against that
Amen.
Person. He's waiting for you to release and have a heart like Stephen, so that he can open up the windows of heaven and pour out to you what he desires to give to you. Don't
Amen.
Hold their sin against them. If or when he answers your prayer, this is what the result's going to be.
Hmm.
He'll either save them or set them free.
Yeah.
And my point is this, if you're a true Christian, that's what you want. Amen. If people have hurt you in the past and you feel ought in your heart towards them, really what you want for that person is that they would be set free, right?
Yeah.
Isn't it? I hope so. If not, you came to the wrong church. If you want your own vengeance, the word of God says, vengeance is mine, says the Lord. You cripple your own self when you let that stuff get up inside of you. How do I stop it? Lord, please help me. Amen.
Amen.
I apply the cross like Robert likes to say in the scripture. Apply the cross to this bitter water.
Yeah.
Make it sweet. Amen?
Amen.
Goes on to say, number three is this. Remember that people are watching you live your life for Jesus. I'm talking to the ones right now that you actually talk about him. I'm not picking on you if you don't. We're all at different places in our walk with God. But don't tell me you're not supposed to talk about Jesus. I mean, if he's living on the inside and he's burning in your belly, he's going to come out of your mouth.
Amen.
Right? Am I telling the truth?
Yes.
I think I am. For 12 years as a Christian, I did not hardly talk about Jesus. But anyway, that's another story. Jesus was the topic of Stephen's conversation, and his passion for the Lord was played out in front of a crowd. We won't know how many people this man's one sermon affected. Maybe till we get to glory. Maybe we'll see a big old group of people that all were present for Stephen's message, and how many lives were changed by that man's message. Amen.